Good morning. Thank you for coming. I'm going to be talking today about aortic injury. So a few goals. I'm going to review the background of acute traumatic aortic injury. I'd like to explore some imaging findings that could be seen in the setting of acute traumatic aortic injury on computed tomography. We will be focusing mainly on CT as it's the modality of choice for this condition. I'm going to discuss some pitfalls that are encountered in the imaging of potential acute traumatic aortic injury, and we'll focus on some key components of radiology reports in patients with acute traumatic aortic injury. So acute traumatic aortic injury is the second most common cause of death from blunt trauma, number one being intracranial injuries, and timely diagnosis is key. About 9% of survivors may rupture within the first 30 hours. We have to make this diagnosis right away. In addition, time spent excluding acute traumatic aortic injury may distract from other life-threatening injuries. In the 21st century, CT is the dominant imaging modality for acute traumatic aortic injury. Chest radiographs do remain a robust screening tool if the patient can verbalize an absence of chest pain. In terms of location of injuries, if you look in the literature, you'll see that rates are typically quoted for about 5 to 9% of patients presenting to the ED in the ascending aorta. That is way lower in our practice. We have hundreds of patients with acute traumatic aortic injuries, and we only have one that was actually in the ascending aorta on CT. It is indeed, however, a higher percentage of autopsies that have ascending aortic injuries. These patients, when you have an injury of the ascending aorta, often don't make it to the hospital. The arch has about 8 to 18% of injuries. Really, the hotbed, though, is going to be the isthmus. For you as radiologists, that's going to be the number one place to look. 90% of ED patients, or at least that's what's reported in the literature, have their injury at this location. Finally, descending aortic injuries, which are quoted as a relatively low number in the literature, only about 1 to 3%, are becoming increasingly recognized. In the era of CT, we're able to pick up small thrombi that are sites of aortic injury. They're probably missed in the angio era. So I think this is probably a gross underestimate for us as radiologists. Descending aortic injuries are probably more common than have previously been reported. In terms of CT for acute traumatic aortic injury, it's very sensitive and very specific. I know there are many different ways to perform trauma CTs. At our institution, we just get one set of images with a fixed delay at 70 seconds. We don't do an angiographic phase on every patient. We feel that venous phase is essential for the detection of other injuries. If you get an aortic or arterial phase only, you're not going to get good organ opacification, and that's going to be important for your trauma patients. We do extend from the thoracic inlet through the femoral heads, and we obtain standard 3 millimeter thick slices at 2 millimeter intervals with an option to reconstruct thinner slices. That overlap is important because multiplanar reconstructions are often essential in evaluating for acute traumatic aortic injury. So in terms of the CT diagnosis of acute traumatic aortic injury, what are we looking for? And basically the first thing I look for is a mediastinal hematoma. And this is a nice example of that. We've got a patient who actually has an aberrant right subclavian artery, and they've got some blood, typically in the range of 40 to 70 Hounsfield units, that's touching their aorta. Okay, so to have an indirect sign of acute traumatic aortic injury, a mediastinal hematoma that matters, it needs to touch the aorta or a major vessel. And it's typically not from, like, the aorta had a hole in it, it bled, and then blood's around the aorta. It's usually from tearing of perivascular adventitial veins and arteries. So the indirect sign of mediastinal hematoma, when you use it alone, that's going to lead to false positives for acute traumatic aortic injury. And it's also important to recognize that you can get mediastinal hematomas from other causes. They may be things like sternal fractures, as seen in this case, vertebral fractures, as seen in this case, or sometimes you may just get a mediastinal hematoma that's kind of hanging out, but not in contact with any vessel, and it may simply be due to a small tear of a vein in the mediastinum. But what I'm really looking for to clinch the diagnosis are direct signs of acute traumatic aortic injury, and certainly the most specific, but probably the most rare, is active extravasation. If you've got contrast extending from your aorta into the mediastinum, particularly within a mediastinal hematoma, that's a great sign of an acute traumatic aortic injury, and we see that in these two patients presented here. The second sign is a very important one, and I think that is one that really got recognized a lot more once CT took over as the dominant imaging modality for acute traumatic aortic injury, and it's shown here. We've got a filling defect in the aorta. That's a thrombus, okay? Any thrombus in the setting of trauma has to be worrisome for acute traumatic aortic injury, bearing in mind that when you have an aortic injury, you can get a small intimal defect. That intimal defect then forms as a nidus for thrombus formation, so thrombus is a surrogate for a subtle aortic injury. This case, another one that's important, you've got what looks like your descending aorta has two lumens. I'm not sure which one really is the actual lumen of the aorta and the aorta on the axial images. Multiplanar reconstructions are helpful in these cases. You can see that there's a clear focal outpouching, okay, from that descending aorta. Okay, I'm not calling it a pseudoaneurysm. That's actually intentional. Some of these injuries that are focal outpouchings are true pseudoaneurysms, meaning they're covered by a portion of the aortic wall. Others are actually just complete contained transections. So when we see this finding, we just call them focal outpouchings in the setting of acute traumatic aortic injury. Occasionally, you'll see flaps of tissue within the aorta, and those may be parts of focal outpouchings or transections, or represent intermedial flaps which have been raised in a short area. Again, another important direct sign of acute traumatic aortic injury. Caliber changes can occasionally be seen in patients with suspected acute traumatic aortic injury, another important finding. And finally, this last direct sign is a fairly rare one, but we do see it on occasion. Two different patients, the patient on top has some contrast within the wall of their aorta and actually had some high attenuating material tracking inferiorly. This is just like what Chris was talking about earlier. This is simply an intramural hematoma as a manifestation of acute traumatic aortic injury, shown as additionally in this lower patient, blood in the wall of the descending aorta tracks up and down, intramural hematoma as a manifestation of acute traumatic aortic injury. So when it comes to making the diagnosis of acute aortic injury, the indirect sign of a mediastinal hematoma, one taken alone, is not very specific. And if you have the indirect sign alone, that usually translates to an indirect management pathway, meaning more imaging. Direct signs, however, are very sensitive and very specific, and they allow the patient to go directly to treatment. Some examples shown here. This is a patient who was involved in a motor vehicle collision. And you can see there is blood around the aorta. It's touching the aorta. There's also blood touching the great vessels. But we didn't really see any definite sign of an acute injury. So what can you do in these cases? Well, you can just follow them up. This is their scan at 48 hours. And you can see that they've developed a small outpouching of their aortic wall. This is a direct sign of an acute aortic injury. Now, this patient was actually, the decision was made by our surgical team to manage them conservatively. They were just placed on an aspirin, and we followed them up, and 8 months later, they still have stayed stable with that small evidence of a focal outpouching in the setting of an aortic injury. Another example shown here, a patient who was in a trauma, has a very indistinct superior aspect of the aorta, has an elevated left hemidiaphragm on CT, definite aortic injury with a focal outpouching, but they've also got a left diaphragm injury. By using CT to make that diagnosis promptly, they can go for one repair, okay? One trip to the operating room, open procedure to fix the diaphragm, endovascular repair of the aortic injury. So making the diagnosis on CT is critical for patient management. All right, let's talk about what makes these cases hard or what situations can make cases of suspected acute traumatic aortic injury hard. And one of them is just unusual location of the injury. I think we're all sort of honed in on that proximal descending aorta, but there are other places you can get aortic injuries, and one is shown here. I mentioned earlier, I only have one case of an ascending aortic injury out of hundreds of cases of aortic injury, and that's shown here. It's a tricky case. It actually came in while I was reading out our resident in the morning. The patient was involved in a car accident on the way to work, and of course, we're not gating our trauma CTs, so the first thing I picked up was, looks like there's some blood around the ascending aorta, and that's a weird finding, but there was also a ton of motion, right? And we've got a ton of pulsation artifact here. And we looked at this slice, said, well, maybe there is an outpouching here. We're not really sure. So what we actually did was we brought the patient back, and we scanned them with cardiac gating. And you can see that there is a clear flap of tissue in the aorta. There's also caliber change and an outpouching. And this patient went to the operating room for an actual transection of their ascending aorta and survived. Another important easy miss or place where you might miss an aortic injury is shown here. This is a 2-year-old who was run over by a truck. And you can see their abdominal aorta here has some blood around it, but also has a clear caliber change and a thrombus within it. Multiplanar reconstructions are helpful in these cases. You can see the aorta widens, has this sort of shelf-like appearance and the thrombus within it. In addition, we've got an associated vertebral body fracture, very closely associated with abdominal aortic injuries. I think it's very easy to miss aortic injuries in the abdomen. They tend to be of lower grade. They may only manifest with a thrombus. And if you don't run the entire aorta from top to bottom, you may just walk past them. This patient, as they were a child, the decision was made to try to manage this conservatively, and they actually did well. They're several years out and have a very similar appearance of their aorta at this time. Abdominal and lower thoracic injuries, as I've mentioned several times, are becoming increasingly recognized. Another patient with an abdominal aortic injury, as shown here, has a thrombus and blood around the aorta, and they're often associated with vertebral body fractures. So if you see a vertebral fracture, particularly looks like a compression type injury, take a very, very close look at your abdominal aorta, as you don't want to miss an aortic injury. Another example of an easy miss is shown here. This patient had a really unusual story. They said, and you never, you can always trust it, but this is what they told the ED doctors, is that they were in their garage and the door of their car closed on their arm, and then they were dragged for like 10 feet. And they came to the ED because their arm hurt, and they got this radiograph, which is certainly not normal. We've got a widened superior mediastinum. We've got high attenuation or opacity extending over the left thoracic apex, the so-called left apical capping. These findings are concerning for an underlying mediastinal hematoma. When you look at the CT, indeed, there is blood which is touching the aorta and the great vessels. And if you don't window it down, you might miss the subtle contour deformity that's present in the brachiocephalic artery. Again, multiplanar reconstructions are essential in these cases and show a focal outpouching of the brachiocephalic artery, confirming a great vessel injury. As this patient only had arm pain, despite the fact of direct signs of a vascular injury, they were simply managed with an aspirin, and they've actually done well multiple years later. Another example of a great vessel injury is shown here, and I mean, I think this is extraordinarily subtle. I actually have to point to it so that it's easy to see. There's a tiny thrombus in this patient's left subclavian artery. You could imagine you could easily just walk right past this if you scrolled quickly through the CT. So again, what I start with in these cases is sort of a top to bottom look at all of the arteries. All right, you're going to have to look at all of them to pick up an injury like that. This patient ultimately went on for angiography, which confirmed the finding, and the patient received a stent at that location. All right, moving on to this case, I think it shows an obvious aortic injury at the level of the isthmus. We've got a focal outpouching. There's blood around the aorta. Everyone sees that. But what you might miss is this tiny thrombus inferiorly. This patient actually has two sites of aortic injury. Another patient shown here, no blood around the aorta, again, but a filling defect in the descending thoracic aorta. When you see this, you have to be thinking about a low-grade aortic injury. Low-grade aortic injuries, sometimes called minimal aortic injuries in the literature, don't really have a consensus definition. You might think of them as a subtle direct sign with no indirect sign. They were possibly missed in the angio era. They may be medically managed. Identifying them is important because we can direct the patient to appropriate triage and follow-up, and they represent an increasing number of acute traumatic, or increasing number of at least recognized acute traumatic aortic injuries, up to 37%. Again, the term minimal aortic injury floats around in the literature. I don't really love that term because it doesn't have a good consensus definition. Some authors will describe it as a lesion measuring less than 1 centimeters with no contour deformity and not associated with a periaortic hematoma. Others allow for longer lesions, and some allow for those with small contour deformities. The Society of Vascular Surgery does have a way of looking at or classifying aortic injuries. Grade 1 tears or type 1 tears only involve the intima. Okay, the goal for these is to treat them with endovascular repair or simply aspirin, depending on the patient. Higher grade aortic injuries, including type 2, which are intramural hematoma, type 3 pseudoaneurysms, and type 4 ruptures are most often treated with an intervention, endovascular if possible, open if not. So what do we do in our practice? We describe injuries with attention to features that form the basis for treatment decisions. Specifically, that's the presence or absence and size of periaortic hematoma, luminal thrombus, intramural hematoma, contour deformity, and active extravasation. We then consult with our physicians to determine acute traumatic aortic injuries that are believed to carry a low risk of rupture. And typically, those are the ones that present with those findings of just the thrombus. Okay, just the thrombus often has a very low risk of rupture. What do we do with low-grade injuries when we don't intervene on them? Well, we follow them. And the follow-up scheme that you used really varies amongst your surgeon preferences, but one example is shown here. Patient has a small thrombus at the level of their isthmus. They were involved in a motor vehicle collision. We followed them up over the next 48 hours, then week, then 1 month, then 6 months, and 1 year. This patient's aortic injury actually resolved at the 1 week point. Why do we need to do that? Well, sometimes these injuries are kind of tricky. This is a patient who is in a motor vehicle collision and had what looked like a thrombus along the undersurface of their aorta. But they had some atherosclerotic disease elsewhere, and on multiplanar reconstructions, it looked like that thrombus was actually somewhat fissured. We initially favored that this was simply just some atherosclerotic disease, so we followed them. At 1 week and 1 month, it looked like they had the same finding again, so we were kind of thinking it was going to be atherosclerotic disease. But ultimately, 6 months later, this finding resolved, and the patient was only on an aspirin, so it probably was an acute traumatic aortic injury. And again, these require follow-up to ensure that no complications such as aneurysms develop. Patients with acute traumatic aortic injury who manifest with thrombi often will have sequela of the thrombi. They can embolize distally. So if you're dealing with a patient who has a trauma and has evidence of infarcts in solid organs or perhaps the bowel, or you actually see an embolism, make sure you have imaging of the chest and go upstream to look for a subtle aortic injury. One such patient was shown here. This is a patient who was in a motor vehicle collision, and their main presentation actually was back pain. They had back pain because they had multiple infarcts in their kidneys. When you went up to their chest, we ended up finding evidence of an aortic injury with two small thrombi located at the site of the aortic injury. All right, let's finish up by talking about some mimics and pitfalls of acute traumatic aortic injury on CT. These are broadly divided into technical artifacts and normal anatomy. The biggest one I think that we encounter, or one of the ones that we encounter most often at least, is pulsation. It's particularly from cardiac motion. It's most pronounced in the ascending aorta. When you encounter it, look at the pulmonary artery. Okay, if it's overlapping with the pulmonary artery, that's probably going to be an artifact and not a true aortic injury. If you're unsure, you could consider electrocardiographic gating on top or ultra-fast high-pitch mode on the bottom. That's going to clean up your motion in the ascending aorta and exclude direct signs of an aortic injury. It's also important to just consider the anatomy and sort of pathophysiology of aortic injuries. Aortic injuries typically manifest with transverse flaps, okay, so the flap should cut across the aorta. Pulsation typically vertically oriented, okay, so if you do a multiplanar reconstruction, you're wondering about pulsation, it's vertically oriented, you're probably dealing with an artifact. Another important mimic is shown here. This patient was seen at the scanner to have some filling defect within their arch as well as this other sort of more linear defect. We noticed this at the time and said, well, maybe we're just dealing with a flow artifact, so we scanned them in a more progressive delayed phase. This is a patient who actually had a low ejection fraction. This is simply a flow-related phenomena. These ill-defined smoke-like filling defects can be a problem with a fixed delay. They can also be a problem in patients with decreased cardiac output, particularly when using faster scanners. Automated bolus timing may be useful to overcome this artifact. And if you see it, you're actually monitoring the trauma at the scanner, consider a delayed phase acquisition. Normal anatomy can also be tricky in the setting of trauma. Sometimes normal anatomy can simulate the indirect sign of a mediastinal hematoma. Seeing here, that looks like there's some high attenuation material adjacent to the descending aorta. Put it on lung windows, that's actually just some atelectasis in this patient who's aspirated. This is a patient who has some actually not high attenuating, low attenuating material, which is surrounding their ascending aorta, two different patients. This measured about 10 Hounsfield units, and these are simply pericardial recesses. Another finding which can be particularly vexing, particularly in younger patients, is shown here. You've got some intermediate attenuation material in the anterior mediastinum, actually doesn't contact the aorta fat plane with between it, and it has islands of fat within it. This is simply thymus. Thymus can be very tricky, but I like to think of it as looking like pancreas. Okay, when you see some tissue in the anterior mediastinum and it's got islands of fat within it, be fairly confident that that's thymus. Of course, if you're not sure if you're dealing with thymus or mediastinal hematoma, your best bet is following up with a repeat CT examination. Ductus bumps and aneurysms can be a bit confusing. Ductus bumps most often have obtuse angles with the remainder of the aorta, and they shouldn't be associated with any adjacent hematoma. Okay, if you're not sure, again, follow them up. A true aortic injury with an outpouching like this, though, you really would expect it to have some blood next to it. Another anatomic variant which can mimic caliber changes in aortic injury is shown here. This is an aortic spindle. Some patients just have a localized dilatation of their proximal aorta at and distal to the level of the isthmus. If you see that and there's no blood around it again, you can be fairly confident that this is simply an aortic spindle. Finally, you may see a branch vessel infundibulum that's rather prominent. The key for differentiating this from an aortic injury is identifying the small vessel which emanates from its apex. And again, you won't confuse that for traumatic outpouching. What about angiography? I haven't talked much about that. It really is unlikely to provide additional useful information. In 2019, it's really reserved for surgeons in the operating room at the time of endovascular repair. If we've got tough cases, we don't recommend angio. It's either going to be repeat short-term CT in 24 hours or some sort of intravascular ultrasound. Case in point shown here, this is a patient with a clear aortic injury on CT. They had to go to an angiogram for renal artery injury, And when they shot the arch angiogram, I mean, you can barely see it. Okay, so these are shown much better on CT, and that is our modality of choice. Finally, a quick mention about endovascular repair and things you might want to consider in your report. Surgeons, when they manage these injuries, they do use the aortic zones by Ishimura to classify their location, and the hotbed is going to be numbers 3 and 4. I'm not going to read them to you, but it's important to be aware that they exist. And I think it's important in your report, particularly in descending aortic injuries that you think might be treated with endovascular repair, to give some measurements of the injury for potential treatment. That includes defining the distance from the left subclavian to the beginning of the injury, keeping in mind that a 2-centimeter seal zone is typically needed to put a stent that doesn't cover the left subclavian artery. You're going to measure the injury itself. You should provide some vertebral artery measurements, okay? And patients who have to have their left subclavian artery covered, if they have a dominant left vertebral artery, they're most likely going to need a left carotid to subclavian artery bypass to prevent spinal cord ischemia, keeping in mind that the anterior spinal artery arises from the left vertebral artery. So in conclusion, CT is the workhorse modality for the diagnosis of acute traumatic aortic injury, and our diagnosis relies on identifying indirect and direct signs. Understanding pitfalls and potential easy misses is key. When I take a look at any trauma CT, the first thing I do is I look for a mediastinal hematoma, and the second thing I do is I follow the aorta and the branch vessels from the top of the scan to the bottom. It's very easy to walk by subtle injuries in the ascending aorta, great vessels, and abdominal aorta. And really, this used to be binary, but now the radiologist is essential in assisting triage. Trauma triage and treatment planning. It's not really enough just to make the diagnosis yes or no. You really need to consult with your physicians and try to describe the risk of the potential risk for rupture of aortic injuries as well as potential treatment strategies. Thank you. Next will be Dr. Sundaram presenting.